is accurate. Excellent. Guys, it is so good to have you here with us on this Easter morning. And my name is Josh, one of the pastors on staff here at State Road, along with Pastor Andrew and Pastor Aaron. And just so glad that you have decided to come join with us this morning to worship our risen Lord. I do have just a couple of housekeeping announcements here before we dive into worship. One is that here midweek, we have a couple different ministries that are going on. We've got Varsity, which is our high school student ministry peer group. That's happening on tonight, actually, 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. That's out in the gym in the youth room. On Wednesday night, we have Therefore Pray, which is a prayer group that meets here from 7 to 8 p.m. Tuesday night, we have Hide and Seek Club, which is our ministry to our littlest worshipers. Yeah, woo! Don't get too excited. Pray for me on Tuesday nights at Hide and Seek Club. On April 13th, at 10 a.m., we have a seniors brunch that'll be meeting right here in the fellowship hall, which is right through this accordion wall over here. Guys, a really exciting weekend. I'm so excited about this. I hope we all take advantage of it. On April 20th through the 21st, we're bringing in some speakers from out of the area. Larry McCall and Jerry Vincent are coming, and they're going to be presenting on some really important topics. Saturday night of that week, from beginning at 5 to 8, they're going to be speaking to people who are not married yet. Maybe you're a single person, or maybe you're in a relationship, and you are just thinking through some things. They're going to be presenting on that night on some things to think about before you get married. I think there's a lot of stuff out there for folks who are married, and I personally haven't been to a lot of events like that, and so I'm excited about that as a thought. So just think about that. You don't need to bring somebody with you. You can just come on your own, or you can come as a couple, whatever you want, but we're going to have some door prizes, some games. They're going to present some really worthwhile things to think about. We're going to give them the pulpit that Sunday morning. They're going to be speaking to parents and grandparents on Sunday morning. And then Sunday night, we'd invite you to come back for those folks who are married. They're going to have a session from 5 to 8 on Sunday night for married folks. And again, just to really looked at their materials, I think it's just going to be really worthwhile. Your time will not be wasted. We're going to have dinner on Saturday night, and Sundays on Sunday for the Sunday night. So come out, and we'll have some ice cream together. And again, games, door prizes, it'll be a blast, as well as very meaningful. So that's all happening on April 20th through the 21st. And I think that's it. In just a minute, we're going to sing some songs. And then after we've sung a few songs, we're going to be dismissing our kids down to junior church. They're going to be meeting the junior church worker at the side door who will take them downstairs. We do ask that you sign your kid in. There's a sign-in sheet in the back foyer. And if your kid is brand new here, please fill out the registration form just so we have some information about your child. You are always welcome to keep your child with you in the worship service. We love having little kids with us throughout that as well. So they're welcome to stay, love to have them, or if they want to go downstairs, that's available to them as well. Either way, we're just glad to have so many little people with us here this morning to worship our Lord. Let me pray, and as I pray, I'll invite the worship team to come on up. Dear Heavenly Father, just thank you for this amazing day. Father, I thank you for the opportunity that we have this morning to worship our risen Lord Jesus Christ and to celebrate together the hope of the resurrection and all that that means. God, I just pray, Lord, that you would move with power here during our service. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would, through the Holy Spirit, just take this morning and use it in ways that are wonderful, unexpected. God, we ask you, Lord, to come and move in this place and in each of our hearts this morning. Father, gathered here into this room are a mix of people, some people who are convinced of the truths of Christianity. Others, Lord, who might be skeptical. And some who are neither yea or nay. They're just find themselves here for whatever reason this morning. And God, I just pray that you would meet all of us at the point of our deepest need today. God, I just pray that you'd speak to everyone. God, just thank you, Lord, for the way that you speak. And just pray, Lord, that you would move with power during the service, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Easter. Resurrection Day. Please stand. We're going to sing to our Lord and Savior this morning.
Thank you. great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into
Jesus, yours is the victory.
our living hope. Praise you, Jesus, for dying for us, for taking our place, paying for our sin and the shame that we feel from sin. Thank you for grace and your gift of mercy. May you be praised this day. We'll continue to worship you because worship is what happens in our hearts. Holy Spirit, speak to us and use Josh and the words that you've given him to help us think and remember and hope eternal. In your name, we pray. Amen. You can be seated. Junior church kids are headed through the middle door.
Let me pray over you, God's people. Dear Heavenly Father, God, it's a big group here in the room this morning, and Father, I just lift it all up to you, God. I bring to you, Lord, the silent cry of each heart. God, we are human beings living in broken bodies, in a broken world, in the midst of broken relationships. God, we look around us and we see so much that is wrong. But Father, we cling with a white-knuckle grip to the promised day when you're going to set all things to rights. God, your word says that there is a coming day where you're going to wipe every tear from every eye. There will be no more mourning, no more death, no more wrong. Father, we look forward to that promised day. And this morning we gather to celebrate the token of that promise, the pledge in the resurrection. Father, we look forward to a coming day when every grave will be emptied. And Father, for those who have put their trust in Jesus for salvation, it will be a day of unspeakable reward. And God, we also want to proclaim to those who have not yet done that, that they can escape from the wrath that is to come. Father, I pray in this time ahead this morning that you would open your word to us, and by your Holy Spirit, guide us into truths that are needed. And I pray this in Jesus' name, amen. Well, it's going to be kind of, if you're somebody who attends with us here regularly at State Road, it'll be kind of an unusual morning, and that my remarks will be brief. No, just kidding. I will be brief, though, this morning, because the main statement that's going to be made is in the waters of baptism. Baptism is a thing commanded by our Lord, and it is simple but very profound. It's a wonderful statement meant to depict glorious truths that are central to the Christian hope. And so that's the main statement to be made here this morning. But just to kind of whet our appetite for that moment, I just want to spend a little time in a text that I don't think is commonly thought of as an Easter text, but which I have come to feel is. And that's in Psalm 3. If you brought your Bibles this morning or you have a smartphone that can look it up, go to Psalm 3. I'm going to be reading from the English Standard Version. And it says this, is the word of King David in the Bible, writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He says this, O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God. For you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing be on your people. What followed Jesus' death on the cross, when he was crucified for our sins, what followed his death was something that we are all sadly very familiar with. The gospel accounts record that there was crying, there was mourning, there were grieving family and friends, and there was a burial in a cemetery. Two men, by name Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, got permission from the Roman governor Pilate to take the body of Jesus and commit it to a tomb. Guys, how many funerals has this very room witnessed? This carpet is stained in tears. There's no doubt about it. There have been so many tears shed in this room. How many of you personally have lost count of the funerals that you've attended? How many of us have stood by the grave of a loved one and felt the crushing weight of the sadness of that loss? We know all too well this pattern of loss, burial, and mourning. It's all tragically familiar. But guys, then something most unprecedented happened. There was crying, there was a burial, there was mourning, there was a sad gathering, but then something happened that had never happened before. The greatest and happiest thing in the history of things. The good news, no, the great news that God's word proclaims to everyone who has ever cried by a graveside of a loved one or who has ever feared death themselves is that death itself has been defeated. Death is dead. Jesus rose from the grave. I am speaking to a room full of people who share together a common fear. Every single last one of you feels the weight of the fact that you yourself will die and people you love will die. It hangs over our gathering this morning in a very real way. It's the great need. It's the greatest enemy. It's the greatest fear. It's the end of all things that we love on this earth. Or is it? I like to make this point every Easter. All of Christianity rises or falls on the truth of the resurrection. If the resurrection never happened, I have completely wasted my life. I have. I have lived my life in the furtherance of a fairy tale, if that is not a fact. But let's put the cards on the table. I'll be intellectually honest about that fact. If you can kick out the resurrection, all of Christianity tumbles. However, if it did happen, and you are not living for the Lord, it is you who is making an absolute abject waste of your life. And there is a coming day where you will deeply mourn the fact that you did not deal squarely with the truth of the resurrection. Now, I can understand somebody who embraces the resurrection or somebody who scoffs at it and dismisses it. What I don't understand is the person who yawns and just refuses to interact with this truth. If this is true, guys, if this happened, the world has changed. And if it didn't happen, then Christianity is not just wrong. It's wicked. It's a con game. Now, I believe there are many wonderful evidences, proofs of the resurrection. I pin all my hopes to it. But just as we are all bound together here in this room by a common concern about the issue of death, the church is bound together by a common hope about how God has addressed that deepest need of humanity. And that's what I want to speak to this morning. 1 Corinthians 15:54 through 57 says this: "Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting?" Now, Psalm 3, with the psalm I just read, is not typically thought of as an Easter passage. But again, I've come to think of it as one, and in fact, it's one of my favorites because of what it says in verses 4 through 5, where the psalmist, in this case David, says, "I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me." We're going to come back to that thought here in just a moment. But the psalm begins in kind of a dark place. He writes, "O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there's no salvation for him in God." A lot of people who study the Bible, experts, scholars, link this psalm to an event in our Bibles, which is the revolt of Absalom. David was a king in ancient Israel. He's considered the greatest of the kings. And he had a son named Absalom who began kind of a civil war, a rebellion. He rose up against his father and had quite a following. And in fact, David had to flee for his life. And many people think that this psalm is connected to that. I think that's perfectly possible, and it makes a lot of sense for the psalm. But I do think that David never makes specific reference to the exact nature of the difficulties that caused him to write these words. So any effort to nail it specifically to one episode in his life or another would involve some speculation. And I like to think that God kept the language of this psalm general so that it can apply to all of our lives. I think all human beings can look around and go, "God, how many things are going wrong? God, how many things threaten me? God, how many are my foes?" So although I don't know exactly what gave rise to these words when David wrote them, I think that these are words for you. All we need to know is that when David wrote Psalm 3, he was in a lot of trouble. He was afraid for his life. His enemies said of him, "There's no help for him in God." In other words, David's situation was so bad that many people felt he was beyond God's help. And those who said that probably didn't feel that God was unable to help David. They probably felt that God was unwilling to help him because he had sinned so seriously. They looked at David's sinful past and figured, surely God is not on his side. He's asked for this. God's not going to help him. There's no help for him in God. And I think many people feel that way about God when they think about the sin in their lives. They hear Christians talk about how in Jesus there's forgiveness. And they think they answer that claim by saying in the privacy of their hearts, "Surely there is no help for me in God. I'm too far gone. I have stopped up my ears too often to the gracious offer of salvation in Jesus. And I've lived my life in the pursuit of things other than him. Surely for me there's no such help." It's a story I told a couple Easters ago, this story illustrates it for me so well. I won't take long on this story, but when I was a kid, behind my house, I grew up in Vermont, and we had a big hill behind our house, big, kind of a small mountain, I guess. But there was a place up there that I found where there was a sheer vertical cliff. And right several feet down from the top of that cliff was a ledge. It was about the same width as a couch. And I became obsessed with getting out on that ledge. I don't know why. I was just a kid. But I can remember the first time I did. The only way to get up there was to climb around the crown of the hill and then work my way down. And the hill was very steep. You had to grab at trees and bushes to arrest your progress. And when you got to the bottom and you kind of looked over the top while you're holding on to trees, it just went right down into this jagged scree of rocks at the bottom of the cliff. And I was like, I'm going to do it for sure. The only way I could do it, though, was to lay on my belly and grab a tree and then lower myself down onto that cliff. And guys, I got to tell you, in that moment, when my feet were dangling over the abyss, it felt like my whole person was concentrated in my toes. I didn't breathe. Every part of me was down in my toes feeling for that ledge. And when my toes made contact with the ledge, I breathed. And then I lowered my feet down. And then feeling how solid it was, I let go of the tree and I slumped down onto that ledge. I tell that story. Some of you, this is not true for you, and I'm not speaking to you. But some of you here in this room feel the same way in your souls. Sometimes it feels like your whole person is in your soul, feeling in the darkness for something solid and true that you can rest all your hopes and all your fears on. You just feel like you're dangling over this frightening abyss. And every fiber of your being is concentrated at times in the sense that there must be something solid and true that I can let my whole weight down onto. Something that will catch me. And when David here says, "Oh Lord, how many are my foes?" That's the kind of thing that makes you feel in your soul, is there something in the midst of all of this that I can rest it on? Something true, sturdy, solid, permanent, forever. Is there such a thing? And my hope this Easter, if you are such a person, is to guide your feet down onto the immovable rock of Jesus Christ. And let the first point of contact between your soul and the hope that we find in Jesus be the truth of the resurrection. This is a thing that you can rest all your weight upon. It is true. It is satisfying. It will hold you. David says, "How many are my foes?" Now, friend, I don't know if you have a lot of foes this morning. I don't know if you have a lot of enemies. But I am confident that you have a couple of very serious ones. Namely, sin and death. You have some very serious enemies. To say the least. You have a big problem. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." Every single last one of us in this room have sinned and we've fallen short. And Romans 6:23 says in an unambiguous way that the wages of that sin is death. It's a point I make quite often, but I really feel the need to be as sharp and precise on this point before we get to the good news in just a second. And I promised I was going to be brief. I already feel myself breaking that promise. Oh, we're in trouble, gang. I'm warm in here. When I say that you have a sin problem, and those of you who attend here at State Road, you've heard this harangue before. Let me be perfectly clear. What you have is a God problem. Your sin is only a problem because God is holy. God is a righteous judge. And he is going to judge all wickedness. And it says that all have sinned. Sin and death are terrible enemies, it's true. But sin is only a terrible thing because God is holy and he is a righteous judge. But here's the amazing thing about Christianity, and I don't throw that word amazing out as hyperbole, just empty rhetoric, a word salad kind of a word. I mean, it is amazing. You can't find anything like this in the whole world. God, in Jesus Christ, took the penalty for your sin. This is an amazing truth. This is at the heart of Christianity. And that brings us to this line in Psalm 3. He says, Lord, I have these foes, and you do too. You have a problem, a sin problem. But he says, I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. The desperate cry of all humanity has risen to the Lord, and his answer to you is from his holy hill where Jesus was lifted up on the cross. And then he says this, I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. You know, throughout Scripture, sleep is used as a metaphor for death, and waking up is used as a metaphor for being raised from the dead. Daniel 12:2 says, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall wake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. 1 Corinthians 15:51 through 52, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpets will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Or Ephesians 5:14, therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. So again, over and over again throughout the Bible, this idea of sleep is likened to death, and so too is the idea of being awakened likened to resurrection. And David calls to the Lord, and I'd invite you this morning to call upon the Lord as well. Here is very simple, the gospel that Christians believe. Gospel is a transliteration. That just means it's a word borrowed directly from the Greek and just brought in, and we plunk down a Greek word into English, gospel. It means good news. Here's the good news that Christians believe. Even though we have all sinned, and the wages of that sin is death, God is offering you, all of us, me, you, everyone, a free gift, and that is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. A wage, of course, is a thing that we earn, deserve. We've done what's needed to get that. And what we all have earned and deserve is death. But God wants to give us a gift, and a gift is different from a wage. A gift is not given because you deserve it. It is simply a reflection of the goodness of the giver. And God wants to give you a gift today, not a wage. What he wants to give you, you don't deserve. You haven't earned. That's why it's good news. What we all deserve, what we've earned, I don't want, and you don't either. And Romans 5:8 says this, but God demonstrates his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Guys, you are a sinner when this gift is offered. You can't say to yourself, well, I have to clean myself up before I come to Jesus. No, it's a gift. And God demonstrates his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And somebody might say, like the enemies of David, there's no help for him in God. I know what you're saying, Pastor Josh, but you don't know my past. You don't know the things I've done. You don't know the ways I have consciously disobeyed God and stopped up my ears when I've heard the truth before, and I've lived consciously in rejection of these things. No, it's too late for me. I want you to own the promise of Romans 10:9, which is, if anyone calls on the name of the Lord, you will be saved. It is not too late. Today is the day, in fact. And Romans 8 says that there is therefore now nothing in all creation that can separate you from the love that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's a permanent thing, once for all. David says, "Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek, you break the teeth of the wicked." And then he makes this statement, "Salvation belongs to the Lord, your blessing be on your people." It's God who saves, and it's you who are blessed. You cannot save yourself. It is God who arises and saves. It is God who strikes and breaks your enemies so that they can do you no harm. And it is him who saves, and you just receive the blessing. That's the good news of Christianity. That is the gospel. And that hope stands alone and unique among the different faiths on planet Earth. Christianity alone celebrates salvation in what God has done for us, not in what we do. We rest in the finished work of Jesus. Now, it's altogether appropriate to celebrate Easter with baptisms, because baptisms do so beautifully reflect the meaning and the hope of the resurrection. In just a moment, I'm going to invite two gentlemen to come down into the waters of baptism. And what's being depicted, this is what God has called us to do. Jesus wore us publicly on the cross, and he asks us to obey the command to be baptized by publicly associating with him in the waters of baptism. And so in the waters of baptism, what's going to happen is we're going to push them down completely under the water. And that is meant to represent Christ going into the tomb. All of our sins that went with Christ, went on to Christ on the cross, died with him, and we were in a sense buried with him in the tomb. And my friend Darren Bonville, who's going to join me here in just a minute, he likes to say, just imagine if all I did was keep you under the water. And in fact, he gave me a straw for his dad. Dave, this is for you. I won't put it in my mouth because you might need it. But just imagine what would happen. Well, you'd die. You'd expire. You can't breathe under there. But no, we're going to lift you back up out of the water, and that represents the resurrection of Christ, that just as Christ was buried, so our old selves were buried with Christ, and we were raised to walk in newness of life in him. In the midweek email, I told the story of when I worked at Camp Maranatha in Southern California. Lived there for about 10 years, and we had one camp in particular that was famous for wanting to baptize people as soon as they made a decision for Jesus. Which I think is great. I think that's the way it ought to be. I think you put your faith in Jesus, let's just get you wet. We should keep the baptism full just all the time. We should have baptisms constantly going. Put your trust in Jesus, let's get you in the water. But I can recall one time, and I don't remember the exact time, but I know it was after midnight. I had gone to bed, and there came a knocking at the door. And I went down there, and it was Jack Williamson. He was a youth pastor with that camp. And he had just led a young man to the Lord, and they wanted to get him in the water. I said, okay, great, let's do it. And as I came out of my house to make my way to the pool, I could see young men were running along and knocking on all the cabin doors in the camp. And they were getting all the campers out of bed. You got to come be a part of this. And we went down and we opened the pool, And, you know, Southern California in the mountains, it's cool at night. It's very cold. And a little bit of a mist was rising off of the water. And I went and sat down. I was there technically as a lifeguard. And I sat down on a deck chair. I actually remember this. I got like the lifeguard, whatever that thing's called. Like I'm going to need it. It was kind of silly, but it was part of my uniform. I had it on. And then all these campers filed in, and they surrounded the pool. And Jack Williamson went down in the water, and he had no introductory words or anything. He just started singing, "Father, I adore you." And all of the teenagers surrounding the pool joined him. And you know how sound carries at night in the mountains. It was just beautiful. All those voices singing, "Father, I adore you." And then the young man went down in the water, and Jack asked him the questions. And he said yes, he believed. And then down he went in the water. And he came back up. And Jack said, "Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life." And then something very unprecedented happened. I'd never seen this done before, but all those high schoolers yelled out, "See ya!" And then they all jumped in the water. And by "see ya," they meant that who this young man had been was gone, washed away in baptism. And he was now a new creation, follower of God. And I love thinking back on that, the picture of them all together in the water. Because baptism is meant to depict a believer's union with Christ, yes, but also the unity of all followers of Jesus, being in the church together. Paul wrote this in Romans 6, 4 through 5, "We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his." I love the four we's in there. We. He's talking to a group. In Ephesians 4, he says this, "There is one body and one spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." So this is a beautiful thing we're about to witness. Two men who want to publicly associate and proclaim that they've placed their faith in Jesus for salvation. And that they are not only joined to Jesus, but they are one with the church. And what I'll just say this is, when I'm done baptizing them, as I like to say, guys, I'm going to open it up to anyone and everyone who can answer those questions. Guys, if you've never been baptized this morning, and I don't care if you didn't bring a towel or a change of clothes, drive home wet if you must. Or I'll loan you my suit. Come do it. The time is now. Guys, do not believe the lie that there is no hope for you in God. Jesus died for your sins. We've all sinned. We all need a Savior, and God has provided a way in Jesus. And at the close of our service right now, I'm going to pray a very simple prayer. Maybe you're convinced of who Jesus is, convinced of your need for him, but you have never personally put your trust in Jesus for salvation. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. I'm not going to ask you to do anything. But if you agree with the prayer I'm about to pray, you can make this your prayer. That's the way prayer works. I'll say the words, but if you agree with them, it's your prayer. You can become a Christian today. There's no magic in the words. You don't have to. It's not like a genie in the bottle where you have to get the incantation just right. It's just from your heart to God. And if you agree with that prayer, then you pass from death to life today. You become a Christian. and all the promises of Scripture belong to you. All I ask, though, and it is a big ask, is if you are such a person and you put your trust in Jesus for salvation, at a minimum, tell me about it. Please tell me. And as a maximum, come jump in the water. Today. I mean it. They got the water up in the 80s, guys. This is unprecedented in the history of State Road that I'm aware of. I can't promise you this will ever happen again. All right, so I'm going to pray. You can make this prayer your very own. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm a sinner. God, I have broken your laws. There are commands in your word that you command us not to do, and I've done them. And there are other things that you command us to do, and I haven't done them, or I've done them very inconsistently. Father, I've sinned. And God, in your word, it says that the wages of sin is death. That's what I've earned. All have sinned and fallen short. God, that is surely me. And I need a Savior, Lord. But God, I've come to understand that Jesus came into the world and he lived a perfect life, completely without sin. And that he went to the cross and there he took my place under your wrath. God, you are a holy, righteous judge. You cannot remain who you are and look the other way on sin. Sin must be punished. But God, you poured it out on Jesus. All of his righteousness was credited to me by faith. And he took all of my sin. Lord, I believe it. I receive it. I embrace it personally. Father, please give me the Holy Spirit to come live within me, to guide me into the truth of your word, and to teach me how to live a life that's pleasing to you. Father, I thank you for this gift of salvation. I know I could never have earned it, but I receive it from you now as a gift. God, salvation belongs to you, and I am blessed in the receiving of that salvation. Father, I cry aloud to you, and I understand the answer that you have sent to me from your holy hill, the hill where Jesus was nailed to the cross. Father, I receive with joy this free gift of salvation. Amen. Amen. Well, at this time, I would ask that those who are going to be going down into the waters of baptism to make their way into the upper room. And I would ask Jake Pickens, can I ask you to go bring up the little ones from downstairs? We want them to be on hand to witness the baptisms. Thank you.
Would you stand, please, and let's sing.
Run to him.
There we go. This time I'll ask Ian Jones to come join me down here. Yeah, there he is. I have a story about Ian, which I didn't tell him I was going to tell. For a long time, a lot of men in the church were getting to know Ian, hanging out with him. And he was coming to church for a long time, I remember. And, you know, communion is something we present as being for Christians. And we're always glad when non-Christians come and bear witness to what we do as Christians when we come to the Lord's Supper and take communion together. And I would watch every Sunday as Ian would let the communion elements go past him. And I thought that was great. Because he wasn't pretending. I think he was really wrestling with the questions and the things we were talking about. He was taking it all very seriously. And he wasn't there. And I thought that was a wonderful way to handle it, and I commend him for it. But then came the day where he put his trust in Jesus for salvation, and I can remember I was watching. And my man took the bread and the cup that Sunday, the next one, and I just rejoiced to see it. So Ian, it's been quite a journey, and it's a journey that you're continuing on. And here in the waters of baptism, Ian, I'm going to ask you 5 questions. First question is this: have you come here today to make a public profession that you have placed your faith in Jesus alone for your salvation?
Yes.
Do you believe the words that Jesus spoke concerning the way of salvation and how to live a life that's pleasing to the Father?
Yes.
Do you believe that Jesus died for your sins, that he was laid in the tomb, and that he was raised again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures? Ian Jones, have you repented of your sins, and are you trusting in the death and resurrection of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
And then my last question. Ian, do you intend, with the help of the Holy Spirit that lives within you, to obey Jesus' teachings and follow him as Lord from this day until that blessed day when Jesus returns to gather his people to himself?
Always.
Then Ian, on the basis of this confession, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, and raised to walk in newness of life. I'm going to ask Pastor Andrew to pray over Ian.
Reminded of your goodness and your mercy through your Son Jesus today. Lord, we're reminded of the sacrifice that was made. Lord, we're reminded also that you defeated death once and for all. And thank you for making that real in Ian's life. Thank you, Lord God, for making it real to us today. I pray, Lord, if there's any who've seen the example that Ian has made, Lord, that they would follow in it. Lord, that we each would know what you have done through your Son. Lord, I pray in the days to come that you would bless Ian, that you would work in his life in a special way. Lord, that he would reach his friends, his family, his neighbors, and his community for the sake of the gospel. Mm. Lord, I thank you for just the testimony of who Ian has been. And Lord, we're reminded of that story that Josh just shared, that we will say see ya to who Ian was. Mm. And so we thank you, Lord God, for your grace and your mercy. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Guys, you missed it. That was where you were all supposed to jump in here. Just kidding. Just kidding. Right now, I'm going to invite Dave Bonville and Darren Bonville down into the baptistry. I forgot my straw. It was, it's in the suit pocket.
I can-
better than 95 points for the whole.
Darren is not sure he's going to be able to get through this without crying. I've been praying for him, but Darren had some things he wanted to share before we ask David the questions and baptize him.
So one of the... most amazing parts about this is that really for me, 20 years ago, roughly 20 years ago on an Easter Sunday morning, I was pastoring in Southern Maine, and I got a phone call from my mom, and just there were a bunch of things going on in the home. Very difficult things. And my mom asked if I would come home. And being an Easter weekend in the church I was a part of, that was a big deal to just up and leave in just a matter of a couple hours. But I knew it was important. And so I made the journey home. And I remember Easter Sunday, getting ready to go to church and inviting Dad, and knowing that everything he was going through. We weren't sure if he was going to come, but at the last minute he joined us. We went to church. There's a message on the resurrection of Christ. Got to the end of the service, and I was very used to, when Dad did come to church prior to that, usually as the service ended, he'd go out to start the car. So as the service was ending, he stood up during the time of the altar call, and I thought, well, he'll go warm the car up. Instead of turning right to head to the doors, I watched him as he turned left, and he went to the altar. We'd prayed for Dad for many years, for that day. And even to this day, I think of what a gift the Lord gave to me and our family to be able to be there in that moment when Dad gave his heart to the Lord. And here we are almost 20 years later. And again, I'm humbled to be in a position to be a part of this decision that my dad has made. And so it's with great honor that I get to participate in this. And I love that all of you can be able to be here and to celebrate with us as Dad follows through. And one thing I want to say is, we prayed for over 20 years for Dad to come to the Lord. It's been 20 years since then to now for the baptism. And I just want to say, I hope you find encouragement. If you're praying for someone to come to the Lord, don't give up. Don't ever give up. God does his work in his timing. And so I just want to encourage you all in that, and thank you all. Be praying.
Thank you, Darren. So I'm going to ask Dave the questions, but then I'm going to ask Darren if you would do the honors of leading him and baptizing him. Dave.
Have you come here today to make a public profession that you have placed your faith in Jesus alone for your salvation?
Yes.
Do you believe the words that Jesus spoke concerning the way of salvation and how to live a life that is pleasing to the Father?
Yes.
Do you believe that Jesus died for your sins?
Yes.
That he was buried and that he was raised again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures?
Yes.
Dave, have you repented of your sins and are you trusting in the death and resurrection of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
And my last question is this. Do you intend, Dave, with the help of the Holy Spirit that lives within you, to obey Jesus' teachings and follow him as Lord from this day until that blessed day when Jesus returns to gather his people to himself?
Yes. Where do you want
me? Take a step forward here.
Yeah.
We got you.
He's going to hold on, trust me. Dad, based on the profession of your faith, it is my honor and privilege at this time to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hold on, let me pray over you.
Oh, Dave, what a joyous thing. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray now for my brother, Dave Bonville. God, that you would just fill him with the knowledge of your will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. God, I pray this in order that Dave might live a life that is worthy of you, that he might be pleasing to you in every way, that he would bear fruit in every good work. God, I pray that he would continuously grow in the knowledge of you. Father, I pray that you would fill him with thanksgiving as he reflects upon the fact that you have brought him out of the dominion of darkness and into the kingdom of the Son, whom you love. Father, I pray that you would strengthen Dave with all power according to your glorious might, that he might have great endurance and patience in the years between now and when Jesus returns. Father, with deep gratitude and love, I thank you for the example of my brother Dave now.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen. Now, hold on. Is there anyone else? If you have placed your trust in Jesus for salvation, but have never entered the waters of baptism, I'd invite you now. If you can answer those questions, yes. There is no reason why you cannot come and be baptized. That's a good question. Okay. Seeing no takers, I will not drain the tub right away. It's not too late if even before you get in your car and leave, let me know. We'll get some people together and baptize you. Thank you.
Please stand. Let's sing together. Here inside, there at
beside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting.
There to my heart.
guys. Thanks for coming. Let me just pray, and then we'll head on out. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful morning. And at the center of it, a beautiful truth that Jesus is raised from the dead, and God, with it, the end of death. Father, thank you for the glorious truth of the resurrection. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace to serve the Lord. Niden, come on up here. He's going home wet. Okay. Niden, have you come here today to make a public profession that you have placed your faith in Jesus alone for your salvation?
Yes.
Do you believe the words that Jesus spoke concerning the way of salvation and how to live a life that is pleasing to the Father?
Yes, I do.
Do you believe that Jesus died for your sins, that he was laid in a tomb, and that he was raised again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures?
Yes.
Niden, have you repented of your sins, and are you trusting in the death and resurrection of Jesus alone for the forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
Last question. Niden, do you intend, with the help of the Holy Spirit that lives within you, to obey Jesus' teachings and follow him as Lord from this day until that blessed day when Jesus returns to gather his people to himself?
Yes.
Praise God. Then Niden, on the basis of this confession, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. Niden, thank you. That was exciting. Thank you so much. Praise God.
Let me pray for you. Lord, thank you for Niden. Lord, thank you for his life. And thank you, Lord, ultimately for allowing him to listen to your call on him. Lord, thank you for the fact that he came in the midst of an unknown thing, right? Stepping in, Lord, in a place that many people would say no. And so thank you for spurring him on today, that he would know the goodness and grace and mercy of Jesus. Lord, that he would join us as part of the family of Jesus, both the greater family and also the family here at State Road. We thank you for his life. I pray, Lord God, your blessing upon it. May in the days to come he serve you with all he has. We pray this in your name. Amen.
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 Thank you, man. Anyone else? Rod Chavez? Okay. All right. I didn't get changed. Andrew did. He's the sucker.
I don't have another set.
Guys, I'm staying wet just in case. Let me know. All right.